Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship this morning at First Presbyterian Church in Hickory. We are glad to have you members of this congregation, and we are glad to have those of you who have joined us for our virtual worship service. I hope you will find this a blessing. Tonight, from 5:30 to 6, we have our family ministry-sponsored Bring One, Get One activity. Please bring school supplies, Clorox wipes if you can find them, and we will give you a First Presbyterian Church logo mask to wear. And we hope you'll be here. It'll be great to see you. If you can come by, we'll keep our distance, but we'd love to lay eyes on you. And then tonight, our session meets to look at and hopefully approve some plans for the fall. We've spent a lot of time thinking about this as a staff, and we're going to think more about it tonight and pray about it as a session. And next Sunday during worship, I want to be able to sort of lay out for you what the fall may look like, understanding that things can change. So I encourage you to make sure to remember to be with us next Sunday morning in worship. Let us prepare to worship God.
Wherever we gather, we give thanks to you, O Lord, with our whole hearts. We will sing your praises before all creation and rejoice in your steadfast love. You have created us, O Lord, and made us for yourself. In you, we become everything you have made us to be.
God shows God's love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Let us now show our love for God by confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Let us pray. God, who created us to praise and who calls us to give thanks to you with our whole heart, we ask that you now come near us in our worship this morning. Guide us, and by your Spirit, help us to be attentive to you as we come together to grow and learn, to be challenged, and to be comforted. We confess that we do not always recognize your presence or understand your ways. We are easily overwhelmed and discouraged when life takes unexpected turns. And we confess that we are quick to give up when things get difficult and quick to question your presence and your power. Forgive us, Lord, and grant us patience to wait for your good timing. Open our eyes to recognize your leading in our lives, to listen for your gentle whisper when we least expect it. And then give us courage to step out in faith, trusting in your leading, even when we cannot see the outcome. Fear not, brothers and sisters, for though the Lord is high, he regards the humble, those who know their need for forgiveness and mercy. Friends, trust this good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and restored to new life. Amen. As you know, things have not been quite as hectic around the church for the last 6 months, and yet the mission and ministry of First Presbyterian has continued, albeit in different forms. One of those forms is the reallocation of three of our most valued staff members to community agencies to give them some of the help they need in this difficult time. With the reduced workload here at the church, Kim Brookman and Mary Putman have been working about a quarter time with Greater Hickory Cooperative Community Ministry, Mary in their pharmacy and Kim in their food pantry. And recently, Jimmy has been reallocated for a couple of days a week to the Habitat Restore, where I think he's quickly become quite essential. Your financial generosity has made this possible until such a time as things can return more to normal. And not only are we able to fulfill our pledges to our presbytery and to the other community agencies that do work on our behalf, but we're able to keep our capable staff able to help these community agencies in the meantime. Thank you, my friends, for your generosity. This is the morning offering.
To the table.
As we gather in our homes to hear God's word read and proclaimed, let us turn our hearts to God in prayer. Gracious Spirit, we need you every day, every hour. We pray that you are with us in this place, for if you are not, then nothing else matters. And if you are, then nothing else matters. I invite you at home to say, Amen. So I have a confession. At a time when local businesses and small businesses are suffering from economic loss due to the pandemic, yours truly still went to Hobby Lobby. It was a random weekend just a few weeks ago in August, and I wanted some fake eucalyptus, quite frankly, for my dining room table. Didn't occur to me to think about how many people would be there. I mean, it was a random weekend in August. It was not too close to Halloween, Thanksgiving, or Christmas, just a Saturday. But holy moly, it was packed. I've never been in Hobby Lobby when it was this crowded. It actually made me kind of nervous because I haven't been around that many people in a long time. When I got in line to pay for my faux foliage, people were respectful about being 6 feet apart. Most everybody there had on a mask, but it took 30 minutes to get through the line. So while I stood there, I actually had ample time to look at all the fall harvest displays. Lots of red, lots of yellow, lots of brown, lots of leaves, scarecrows, turkeys, and of course, pumpkins. Lots of decor that had phrases and words like give thanks, blessed, gather. At first, I didn't think anything about it. I mean, Hobby Lobby is full of stuff like this. Plenty of us have those words on wooden signs in our homes. But then I paused, thinking about those words in the midst of where we are right now, in the midst of a crisis that feels a lot like Groundhog Day. A crisis where it can be hard to give thanks, where we sometimes feel blessed, but more often probably feel stressed. And especially when gather feels like a faint memory. In addition to things like give thanks, blessed, and gather, Hobby Lobby has lots of signs printed with scripture. I'm sure many of you know this. Signs like, you have filled my heart with joy. Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. And as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I know that some decor like this serve as good reminders for us. These verses and sayings, they're inspirational. A sign that reads, give thanks, sounds a lot like the first line of Psalm 138. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. But I've not come across any sign that reads, I am worn out, O Lord, have pity on me. Give me strength, I am completely exhausted. I think that would look nice on some throw pillows. Hobby Lobby and other enterprising businesses are making good money off what might be more sentiment than real affirmations of ongoing faith. But they don't have to be just sentiment or decor. If every time we hang those signs, we do so because we know deeper in our hearts that it is a constant reminder of the journey of faith. Do you remember that bit from Jeff Foxworthy's comedy routine where he would repeat silly and obvious things people say, and then he would say, "Here's your sign"? Well, let's go a little DIY. Let's help each other put up these signs. Let's do this like a home renovation or design on a dime budget. Let's figure out where give thanks, blessed, and gather can go in our homes and in our hearts. Psalm 138 gives voice to a faith that is living, honest, and communal. The words of this psalm can show us how the poem of our ancient faith guides us in the midst of a crisis. In this psalm, we can be anxious and doubtful and faithful all at the same time. It begins with an affirmation that God is a God like no other. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praises. I bow down to your temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and faithfulness, for you have exalted your name and your word above everything. Praising God with our whole heart has an effect on our system of loyalties. When we praise the Lord with all that we have, other gods, those who are competing for our attention and our trust and veneration, they recede to the background as the glory of God overwhelms them. When we praise God with our whole heart, God's glory overwhelms lesser gods. God's glory overwhelms them. Declaring that we give thanks to God before all other gods means that we are declaring an allegiance of sorts. It means we're making a shift, a turn, a reorienting of our priorities. To give our whole heart in thanksgiving won't be a one-time thing. It will be a journey, lifelong, that will eventually have a way of reorienting our lives toward an intimate knowledge of God's steadfast love and faithfulness. This, then, is the affirmation of our collective faith. So hang this sign as a reminder. Give thanks. Maybe this sign hangs above your toothbrush, a place where you can see it every day. Or maybe it needs to be a magnet on the front of your refrigerator. Give thanks, because in doing so, you will reorient your life toward God's goodness, faithfulness, and steadfastness. You will see God's hesed at work in our crisis-laden world. Now, what about blessed? This sign is a little difficult because at first we want to put it everywhere. All over the house, the kids' bedroom, the kitchen you just redid. But here's the weird thing about being blessed by God. It often comes with hardship, suffering, and grief. Anyone who has gone through the worst for the sake of God, for the sake of truth, will tell you that if you hold on to the end, the suffering almost always offers a blessing. On the day I called, you answered me. You increased my strength of soul. All the kings of earth shall praise you, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth. They shall sing the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he perceives from far away. Be blessed, people of God, but not in the way that you might think. More like being blessed like Job, who lost almost everything, but saw the glory and the immensity of God and stood in silent, astonished awe before it. Job suffered greatly, and even though he was given tenfold what he originally lost, I don't think that's Job's blessing. His blessing was that he was privy to God's own court. He was given insight into the vast creative energy that is the divine. His blessing came in staying true to himself and to God, and seeing truth that his friends did not. So don't put this sign in your bathroom. Put the blessed sign where you lay your head at night and cry. Put your blessed sign near the chair where you sit when you are anxious. Put that blessed sign over your front door because the people and animals that you love most are inside. There's a house in our neighborhood with a yard sign that always has scripture on it. Once, when I drove by, it said, "I will punish the wicked for their iniquity." That does not sound like a sign you would put over your fireplace. I think this one is a much better option. When you have more than you need, build a bigger table, not a higher fence. You know what you can do at a bigger table? Gather a lot of people. The image that Scripture uses over and over of how the kingdom of God looks is the image of a feast with enough for everyone, plenty of good things to eat and drink, and just like our communion liturgy affirms, plenty of people who come from east and west and north and south. There is also a feast of relationships and community at this table. They come together, they gather together to be with one another and be with the Lord. One of the best gathering songs I know is "Crowded Table" by the group The High Women. If you don't know it, I give you permission to hit pause on the sermon and search it on YouTube. But I do think you should come back to the service. The chorus of that song goes like this: "I want a house with a crowded table, with a place by the fire for everyone. So let us take on the world while we are young and able, and bring us back together when the day is done." Gather. Gather at a bigger table. Gather at a crowded table. Gather around the fire and be warmed. Gather back together when the day's work is done. Put that sign in your breakfast room. Put that sign at your kitchen island. Put that sign on the table where you light candles for fancy family dinners. Put it on the sofa where you sit and watch Disney Plus. Put that sign at your crowded table. Gather. Gather even when it cannot be in person. I know I've told you the story before of how one of my seminary professors confessed that he belonged to a church community not because it fed his faith, but because he realized when he didn't have the strength to believe, someone in his church family did. Someone could believe for him. When we gather our hearts and minds like that, even if it can't be in person, we are given the chance to be the body of Christ with and for each other. And in God's grace, we have faith for each other, even when keeping the faith is hard. So we right now gather in spirit, trusting that God, who transcends time and place, is always at work in our lives, and that that God will not forget the work of his hands. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve me against the wrath of my enemies, and you stretch out your hand, and your right hand delivers me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. We gather in different places, but still worship the one we love and serve. And when we gather, we know that some of us are anxious and doubtful. Some of us are bedrock sure and certain. And some of us have camped in that middle ground somewhere in between for a long time. But here's the thing. When we gather, we realize the table has been built big enough for all of that. Our psalm ends with that anxious and honest plea for the Lord not to forget the work of his hands. The psalm begins with heartfelt praise of thanksgiving. And this psalm assures us that even in our suffering, God is still at work in our lives, and that is our blessing. So maybe take a trip to Hobby Lobby or downtown, or maybe dig out things in your own garage to make a sign. And put it up. Let's be a people who give thanks. Let's be a people who recognize that we are blessed. And let's anticipate that when we do really get to gather together, that the glory of God will overwhelm us. In the name of the one who is our constant companion. Amen.
Would you pray with me? To you, O God, we pray. To you we lift our hearts and voices, asking that you answer us, Lord, as we call upon you now. For your church across this world, Lord, we pray, that Jesus' followers everywhere may seek and receive the unity that he and his mission give us. We pray for our partners in mission, for John McCall in Taiwan and Gary and Marlene Van Brocklin in South Asia. We pray for our sister churches and their pastors in Guatemala and in Malawi, for the doctors and nurses of Nkoma Hospital, and the teachers and students of Ebenezer School. Sustain them by your Spirit in the knowledge of their calling and of our prayers. We pray for our church and all congregations which are leaving behind the summer and are launching into a fall like no other we have known. For this particular church, we pray, for the staff members you have blessed us with. We pray for Heather and for me, for Sarah, for Catherine, for Jenny, for Stephen and Carol Ann and Martha, for Mary and Kim and Jimmy and both Matts, for our session members as they guide us, for our preschool teachers, hoping soon to welcome their children back. for all of our members who are reaching out to folks, for Bible study leaders, youth advisors, and Stephen ministers. With your Holy Spirit, strengthen this body of Christ during this challenging time. Reveal to us the new things you're always doing, and show us how we can be faithful to follow Jesus in our time. Lord, we pray for those who are ill or close to death, those we know and those known only to you. We pray for those who are isolated and lonely and missing the relationships that once gave them joy and meaning. We pray once again for teachers and administrators, students and parents at every level of our education system who are facing such difficult challenges at this time. Finally, we pray for people and situations that we now name before you in silence. O Lord our God, as we lift our hearts and hands to you, reach out to us in mercy. This we pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we are bold to pray as he has taught us.
Our Father,
our Father,
our Father,
who art in heaven,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
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 Every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. The only one who could ever save.
Frederick Buechner says that life is sometimes like the Hebrew alphabet. It's all consonants and no vowels. All by itself, it's hard, harsh sounds that are impossible to vocalize. Now, of course, native Hebrew speakers and readers know instinctively where those vowels go. They know how to put them in between the consonants so that the language is speakable and pronounceable. Buechner says that's what faith does for us. It supplies the vowels to help our lives make sense. So in the jumble of consonants that our lives throw at us, we are given by grace the vowels we need to make something lovely out of it all. May words from things like Psalm 138, may they be the grace and the vowels in our lives. May they bury themselves deep in our hearts so that in times like these, when we need them, they pour forth. May that be so this day and every day. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
But deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen.